This photograph was taken for publicity purposes by the manufacturer of the aircraft. The arrow points to a disc-shaped flying object, which was not noticed until the photograph was developed. This is an enlargement of that disc. This object was photographed in the skies off the coast of California by an officer of the SS Ramsey. This is official U.S. Coast Guard photograph number 5554 of unidentified flying objects over the Coast Guard station in Salem, Massachusetts. None of these phenomena has ever been successfully explained. Our first guest on To Tell the Truth is one of the world's leading authorities on unidentified flying objects like these. What is your name, please?
My name is Donald Keyhoe.
My name is Donald Keyhoe.
My name is Donald Keyhoe.
Only one of these gentlemen is the real Donald Keyhoe. The other two are imposters and will try to fool this panel. Tom Poston, Peggy Cass, Orson Bean, and Kitty Carlisle on To Tell the Truth. To Tell the Truth is brought to you this evening by Texaco. In all 50 states, you can trust your car to the man who wears the star. The biggest friend your car ever had. And now, here's our host on To Tell the Truth, Bud Collier!
Thank you very much. Welcome once again to Tell the Truth. Good evening, Collier.
Good evening, Bud.
You're a bra-brick lot tonight. Okay, in front of you are envelopes. Open the one that's marked number one and follow along as I read from my copy of this first story, if you will. I, Donald Keyhoe, am a graduate of the United States Naval Academy, a retired Marine Corps pilot, and have been an aviation writer for many years. Currently, I am working in Washington, D.C. as director of the National Investigations Committee on Aerial Phenomena. NICAP is a scientific organization which was especially created 10 years ago to investigate the facts surrounding unidentified flying objects, known as UFOs or flying saucers. Recently, there's been another rash of reports of strange things in the sky. In the past 20 years, there have been over 10,000 such sightings of UFOs. While many of these flying objects have been satisfactorily explained as a result of natural phenomena, others so far defy logical explanation. It is the position of NICAP that there is nothing to be gained by secrecy, and that a thorough and intensive scientific investigation of unidentified flying objects would give the subject the dignity and importance it deserves and quite possibly reveal some startling facts. Signed, Major Donald Keyhoe. So, panel, these three gentlemen all claim to be Major Donald Keyhoe. Let's start the questioning with Tom Poston. Tom?
Thank you, Bud. One thing that's puzzled me always, number one, has there ever been any photographic, physical evidence of terrestrial disturbance by these UFOs?
Yes, last year in South Africa near Pretoria, one of these objects was seen by local police on a highway, and as they approached it with their police cruiser, it discharged a blast of flame onto the highway and took off at high speed. And when they checked it, they found that the pavement had been, a hole had been broken in the pavement about 6 feet in diameter, and the macadam road was set on fire and blazed for about 3 hours. And this was officially confirmed by the commandant.
That's exactly the kind of thing I mean. Number two, any of these things happen in this country?
Yes, out in Denver, near Denver, Colorado, there was one that took off from a snow-covered area, and there were signs of it in the snow.
That's what I... Number three, was there any radar...
Peggy Cass.
Number three, where do you suppose they come from?
Other planets, perhaps. That's the best explanation we can think of.
I don't think they should come down here. Go away. Number two, it says it was Coast Guard photograph number 5,554. Have you taken pictures of 5,554 of these things?
Well, that's a number of a Coast Guard photograph, but that doesn't necessarily mean that they were all the flying objects.
I saw in a national magazine a picture of one, and it looked like a big hamburger with green filling. Now, they do come in sort of different shapes and sizes, right?
Most of the sightings describe disc-shaped objects. In fact, the Air Force Secret Project Grudge Report years ago confirmed that.
Thank you. Number three, do they make any noise when they're flying by?
A number of witnesses have described a whirring or humming noise, yes.
Thank you. But number two, are there little green people running
around? Orson Bean around in Peggy's head. Number two, what was the name of your first book?
Flying Saucers, Outer Space.
Number one, do you agree with that?
No.
All right, number one, let me ask this of number three. Number three, what does Variety mean to you?
It's an entertainment magazine.
Does it mean anything else to you?
Yes, one of its writers, Frank Scully, is very interested in the subject.
All right, number one, who said swamp gas recently? Who said that
Dr. J. Allen Hynek, the Air Force number one consultant.
Mm-hmm. Number two, who coined the phrase UFO? Who first said...
This was first used about 10 years ago when they organized NICAP.
Number one...
Kitty Carlisle.
Number one, who is Gerald Hurd?
Gerald Hurd is the author of a book, Is Another World Watching?
Thank you. Number two, is your organization sponsored by the government in any way?
No, it is not.
In other words, number three, do you believe that the Air Force is trying to keep secrets from the general public and you are going to expose them?
I'm sure they are.
You really think so?
I do indeed.
Number one, in Gerald Hurd's book, it was said that there was a great concentration of unidentified flying objects over Fort Knox for a while. Do you remember that?
Yes, that was a case in which Captain Thomas Mantell was killed chasing one of these objects.
Right. Number two, were there any manifestations of burnings or anything in Michigan?
I don't believe so. It's still under investigation if you're speaking of the Ann Arbor and Dexter.
Right. Now, Dr. Mr. What is his name? Heineken?
That's all we have time for, I'm sorry to say. We can go on with this and make one spot of it and go all night and still not wind up all the things we would like to find out about, and I wish we could. But it's time to vote now, so mark your ballots, if you will, panel. Mark them without any consultation, which you might be tempted to do in this occasion at all. And, of course, don't change once you have marked. Vote now for number one, number two, or number three. Team of challengers will, of course, receive $250 for every incorrect vote. Ballots all marked, panel? Very well. Tom, for whom did you vote?
I voted for number one because of his lack of hesitation about any of his answers. He even had too much information, but gosh, he was great about telling us he looks like a soldier.
Peggy Cass.
Well, I voted for number three because of Frank Scully because he looks like a Marine.
Orson Bean, which one do you think it is?
I didn't vote for number two because the name of the book was Flying Saucers Are Real. I was torn between one and three. Three knew Frank Scully, but I felt that one was a little more convincing.
That one has just been cited.
That's right. Only swamp gas.
Well, I didn't want to vote for number one because he's made up and his hands don't match his face. And if it was the real one, maybe they wouldn't do that. But on the other hand, he knew everything. And so I had to vote for number one.
Well, that's a round Robin Hood's barn way of getting there, but there it was. In any event, the votes are in and the minds are made up. Let's find out now. Which one of these three gentlemen, in truth, is Major Donald Keyhoe? Will the real Major Donald Keyhoe please stand up? Major, let me ask you something. If I were to cite what I pretty well thought was a flying saucer, not a figment of my imagination, what should I do?
Send a report to me or to our organization at 1536 Connecticut Avenue, and that applies
Washington,
to anybody
D.C.
who would... Yes, Washington, D.C. Anyone who would like information on this subject.
Thank you very much. And keep after it till you find out what they are, will you?
We're close to it.
Are you? Number two, what is your real name and what do you really do?
I'm Walter Seymour, Jr., and I'm a regional sales manager in the credit card division of American Express.
Thank you, sir. Number three, what is your real name and what do you do, sir?
I'm Donald Dillon. I'm an editor for UPI. That's United Press International.
Well, checking the score, we find that the panel almost came close to having unanimous truth in this fact, but there was one incorrect, and that's worth $250 divided up to you gentlemen three ways, and we thank you for being with us and for this very exciting story. Good night, and God bless you. Now let's meet our next team of challengers.
What is your name, please?
My name is Jeanette Campbell.
My name is Jeanette Campbell.
My name is Jeanette Campbell.
Panel, please listen, look, and follow along as I read if you will. I, Jeanette Campbell, work in a club in London, England. What makes this club unusual for England is its decor. The layout is like an old-time American Western saloon, complete with rough-hewn timber walls, swinging doors, deer-horn coat hooks, a noose hanging in one corner, and even a sheriff to oversee the whole operation. All the employees are dressed as cowboys and cowgirls. The club's main feature is gambling, which has recently been legalized in England. I am a croupier and dealer in one of London's newest casinos, The Maverick. Signed, Jeanette Campbell. Three young ladies all claim to be, as you heard, Jeanette Campbell. We start the cross-examination with Orson Bean. Orson.
Thank you, Bud. Number two, sweet thing. there's a famous nightclub in Paris that copies an American Western motif. Do you know what that is?
Jimmy's.
Jimmy's?
Mm-hmm.
I'm thinking of another one. Number three, not a discotheque.
No, I'm sorry.
You don't know that. Number one, do you know it?
No.
Number one, there's a famous club in England, Raymond's Review Bar. What does that feature? What kind of entertainment?
Cabaret.
Cabaret? Number two, any special kind of cabaret?
Not that I know of.
Number three, do you know it?
Strips.
Strips.
What?
Yes. I only heard about it.
Kitty Carlisle.
Number two, do you deal anything in particular as a croupier?
Yes, I deal in roulette and blackjack.
Uh-huh. Number three, how did you learn this?
We were taught.
Where?
At the club.
Oh, number one, there isn't a special college for croupiers.
There are schools, but I was trained at the club.
Number two, do you have to be good at accounting or numbers for this?
Oh, I should say so.
And are you good?
I hope so.
Number one, how long are you allowed to deal the game? Do you deal roulette too? Are you
yes,
roulette
I do.
Do you speak in French? Do you say fête bourgeois and all that thing, or do you speak in English?
No, it's in English.
Ah.
Tom Poston.
Thank you. Number two, what is a shoe? What do you use a shoe for besides horses in your place? But I mean in...
That's where you deal the cards from.
Thank you. Number three, there are two games that use a shoe. What are they?
We use shoes in everything, in actual fact, in blackjack as well.
But oh, you do.
Chemin
de fer. Well, where does it travel around? Chemin de fer and one more.
And we use it in blackjack also.
Okay. Well, yes, I know what you mean.
Baccarat.
Number one, what is a faro? Faro is a gambling game. Are you familiar with that?
I don't know it.
Do you know what chuck-a-luck is, number one?
Peggy Cass.
Thank you. Number three, when it comes to food, do you have a chuck wagon?
No, we don't. We have a restaurant upstairs.
Oh. What kind of Western food do you serve up there?
The only Western thing we have on is a Maverick steak.
Thank you. Number two, what's a tin horn?
I'm afraid I don't know.
Oh, but watch out for those. number three, if somebody says belly up to the bar, what does that mean?
Oh, my. I'm sorry, I don't know.
That's congratulations.
Well, number one, are any of you girls dressed up as dance hall hostesses, or are you all just plain cowgirls?
We're just plain cowgirls.
And that's it.
Sad.
Time to take your lariats and mark your lassos, if you will. Mark your ballots. Mark them at once. Without any consolation and without, of course, changing after you have marked. Vote now, if you will, panel, for number one, or for number two, or for number three. Ballots are all marked, I see. So, Tom, for whom did you vote?
I voted for number three. She seemed to know Orson's favorite. And she answered all the other questions right.
Peggy.
Well, if I know Orson, that's a strip joint. And belly up to the bar, I mean, it was an old Western thing. It was, come on, pal, belly up to the bar, and he stuck his stomach against the bar and drank. I voted for number three.
Orson.
Oh,
a little
close.
Bit of folklore.
Yes, wonderful. I voted for number three as well. I really wasn't going to.
It's a three.
It's a three. I was convinced it was number one because she looks very English, but number three said, in actual fact, it's such and such, and that sounds so English, too. And she knew about Raymond's Review Bar, which is a wild place where they have crazy strip teasing at 3 p.m, they told me.
Yes, thank you very much. You're kidding.
Nothing left but a Band-Aid.
Oh, sorry. You've confused me, sir. I voted for number three. Number two said it was Jimmy's as the crazy horse in Paris.
That's the one I was thinking. Maybe
yeah.
Jimmy's.
Maybe there's
no,
another
Jimmy's
one. Anyway, I think the other two look more like croupiers because number three has such a terribly kind face.
Oh, that makes it unanimous all the way down the line. All four of you voted for number three. So let's find out how right or wrong you may be as we learn which one of these lovely young ladies in truth is Jeanette Campbell. Will the real Jeanette Campbell please stand up?
Michael Orson.
Well, they pulled it up, though. Thank you very much. And a good job by all of you. Number two, what is your real name and what do you really do?
I'm Astrid Seymour. I'm the stewardess for Pan American World Airways.
Thank you. And number two, you got all the votes. What is your real name with your kind face and what do you do?
My name is Wendy Tripp, and I'm a supervisor at the Top of the Sixes here in New York.
Well, I don't have to tell you to check the score because you probably not only know how much it is, but you've spent the money already. There were four incorrect votes at $250 each total, therefore $1,000 to you, ladies. And thank you for being with us. Good night, and God bless you. And now let's meet our third team of challengers. What is your name, please?
My name is Theodore Isaac Rubin.
My name is Theodore Isaac Rubin.
My name is Theodore Isaac Rubin.
Again, follow along with me, if you will, panel. I, Theodore Isaac Rubin, have just written a book aimed at this country's 80 million overweight people. It contains no specific diets, but rather explains how to lose pounds by getting into the right mental attitude. In order to reduce, people must first admit that they are fat, second, acknowledge that fattiness is not attractive, and third, stop functioning as human garbage pails. Once embarked on a diet, one must set his sights low and divide the total projected weight loss into small achievable units of 5 to 10 pounds. He must get lots of sleep, not eat out, and most important, learn to think thin. My book contains chapters such as Beware of Friendly Enemies, The Night Eaters, Let Love Motivate You, and Help, I'm Starved. Also included is a list of ammunition foods, the kind you can eat all you want of, comforting foods, those with low calorie content, and poison foods to be avoided like the plague. Written from personal experiences, my book is called The Thin Book by a Formerly Fat Psychiatrist. Signed, Theodore Isaac Rubin. Very well, panel. These three gentlemen all claim to be, as you heard, Theodore Isaac Rubin. We'll start this one with Kitty Carlisle. Kitty?
Thank you, Bud. Number three, should I address you as Dr. Rubin?
Yes.
Dr. Rubin, what is the chapter about Help, I'm Starved?
Well, essentially, this is a chapter designed for anybody in an emergency. Quick fill up with soda, pickles,
I see.
Cantaloupe, etc.
Thank you. Number two, are you a psychiatrist, too?
Yes, I am.
Where did you study?
I studied at Columbia University, and I took my graduate work at NYU Medical School in Melbourne.
Tell me something. How much did you weigh before you got thin?
249.
Number one, how much did you weigh?
210.
And how long did it take you to get out of this terrible trap?
4 months.
Is that all? Number two, is this rather like Alcoholics Anonymous, that you have somebody to come and help you?
No, it's an independent practice that you do by yourself and a very slow program.
Tom Poston.
Well, I'd like to ask number three how fat you were before, if I may.
I weighed 255 at my top weight.
How long did it take you to lose?
Oh, about a year.
Number two, how long did it take you?
It took me about 9 months.
Number one, 4 months seems to be extremely fast. How did you do that with just little divisions of total projected weight loss?
Well, I had to lose about 50 pounds only, 45 actually, and I just divided it in 4 months, and I decided I would do it by the first of the year.
Boy, you sure did good. Number two, when you... ice cream is said to be non-fattening. Is that true?
No, it's very fattening.
Number three, do you agree with that? I've heard many people say that ice cream is not fattening by itself.
I would say it's fattening. At least ordinary ice cream is.
Peggy Cass.
Thank you. Number two, could you tell me two comforting foods?
Comforting
for help.
What?
Comforting food would be something like a lean hamburger. It would be something like chicken. Something that you need to make you feel good. You're not going to eat a lot of it. The calories are quite low.
Well, number three, I don't think that can compare in comfort with ice cream. Now, I would like to know poison foods. Who eat poison foods anyway?
Poison foods are high-calorie foods, and the particular poison foods for you or me would be those that we're particularly addicted to.
Let's not get personal. I'll come to your office and pay your fee.
Orson,
thank you. Number three, is Dowager's hump psychosomatic?
I wouldn't know.
You wouldn't know? Well, it's a combination of two fields. Number one, how many people are fat in spite of, like, a happy fat people? Are there any happy fat people?
No, I'd rather say that the people that are jolly usually tend to be fat.
People who are
usually,
jolly...
The happy people are usually inclined quite often to eat.
Well, number two, my grandfather's 90 years old. Bud knows him.
Yes.
He's a great man. He still likes booze and women, and he weighs 110 pounds, and he's eaten a half a dozen donuts every day for 85 years. Tell me about him, number two, in your own words.
I can't tell you a thing.
Isn't that extraordinary?
That's excellent. That's a fantastic habit.
Thank
that's
you, number
all
two.
That's we have time for. Also, I must tell you, you should be conscious of the way every time you say, mention the term Dowager's Hump, both Kitty and Peggy go, immediately, every time you use it. Time to mark him out, so mark him immediately, without change, if you will, and without any consultation. Just vote now for number one, number two, or number three. All ballots marked. Tom, for whom did you vote this time?
I voted for number one because he's going to give a lot of strength and courage to people who want to diet. Did all that work in 4 months.
Peggy.
I don't believe you could do all that work in 4 months and still look that good, number one. So I voted for number two because he's a psychiatrist and they're inclined to be very serious. And he'd believe lean hamburger was comforting when everybody knows it's chocolates.
Orson B.
It's the saddest show on television. I voted for number two because he knew about my grandfather.
Who doesn't? It's worth knowing. Kitty.
I voted for number two because he refused to comment on your grandfather.
So again, there we have the votes all in and the minds made up. Let's find out immediately which one of these gentlemen, in truth, is Theodore Isaac Rubin. Will the real Theodore Isaac Rubin please stand up? Once again. Oh, my. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. Oh, this is a rare night. A rare night to have that panel skunked twice in the same evening. Undoubtedly, the name Theodore Isaac Rubin sounds familiar to many of you because in addition to his book on dieting, Dr. Rubin has written 7 novels, including one which was made into the award-winning film David and Lisa.
Oh.
How? Number one, you got 1/4 of the votes. What is your real name and what do you really do?
My name is George Zesevic, and I'm area manager for Export Division of Chrysler Corporation.
Number two, you got the other 3/4 of the votes. What is your real name and what do you do?
My name is Roger Singer. And I work with inventors, and I'm president of a company that helps inventors to market their inventions, Market Potential Corporation in New York.
Thank you very much. And checking the score, of course, we find they were all wrong again. That means $1,000, gentlemen, and thank you very much for sharing your evening with us. Good night, and God bless you. Good night. night, panel. Good night,
bud.
And don't forget to tell the truth.
To Tell the Truth is a Mark Woodson, Bill Cotman production, brought to you tonight by a Phillips Milk of Magnesia. A little Phillips for antacid relief, more for irregularity. Regular or mint flavor. Johnny Olson speaking. Tonight's program pre-recorded.